Welcome to the Forbes India Cover Story podcast series in association with theindicast.com. My name is Abhishek, and this issue is a quirky one. It celebrates the life, or rather the working style of Sridhar Vembu, founder and boss of Zoho Corporation, which offers online applications to enterprises across the globe. The fact that he has chosen to work from Tenkasi, a sleepy hamlet some 650 kilometers from Chennai, holds some lessons for corporate India. Joining me on the call to talk about it all is Nandika Tripathi, who's done the cover. Hi, Nandika. Congratulations on yet another cover, by the way, and welcome.
Hi, Abhishek. Thank you so much.
Take us through the reason why you chose to do this in the first place. The times are such that almost all of India is working from home, but it just so happens that the home that Mr. Vembu has chosen for himself is an unlikely one for somebody who heads a billion-dollar enterprise.
Sure. So almost 2-3 weeks back, we had a virtual conference in which it was an event in which we invited CEOs from different sectors. Sridhar was one of them. In the virtual conference, he shared how he moved to this village in Tenkasi even before the pandemic started, and his rural vision to create small offices in rural areas and attract more local talent from there. This was his vision like a lot of years ago, and then he wanted to work on it. He decided to move there, and that's how we decided to do a story on him.
How many people, his friends, relatives or folks who knew him, did they call him crazy? How was it taken in the first place when he decided to make that move?
It was pretty unusual, you know, a CEO who was based in the US for so many years suddenly decides to move in a totally remote area, right? So everyone was, you know, astonished, and I was speaking to his co-founder and everyone, and they were like, you know, he's very farsighted. He already predicts something that is going to happen later in future, and he works on it.
It doesn't appear like it's a statement or a fad made by a CEO or a boss of an organization like his, that, hey, listen, I am working out of a village somewhere, and it's quite cool. There appears to have been a proper plan to it over the years. In fact, one of the products called Zoho Desk, a customer service software, was born in Tenkasi.
Yes, yes, correct. Tenkasi is a town, and the office is in Mathalamparai, where they built this product called Zoho Desk, and it was from the scratch. It was built in this remote area, and they built this office back in 2011, and that's when they developed this product. His vision is to be, you don't have to be in the urban hubs or areas to develop a world-class product. His vision is to move the Silicon Valley to rural areas, which actually worked out well when they were successful enough to build this product out of a rural area.
So how far has he gotten into his dream or the vision that you just mentioned about taking Silicon Valley to the village? He has an office also in Reniguntla in Andhra Pradesh. What is the eventual vision?
He wants most of his employees to work from their own hometown. They don't want them to migrate. And he also told us that, you know, I never wanted to buy or build a office in Bangalore or Chennai because it is already overcrowded. I don't want to add up more to it, right? So he always encourages his employees to, you know, be in their hometown and work from there. And also he wants to create small centers and offices where 10 to 20 people can work, and those can be the people belonging to that village. Zoho currently has almost over 8,000 employees in India, out of which 500 of them are working in these two rural centers.
Doesn't this fly in the face of convention of IT outfits who spend a lot of money in building a state-of-the-art office complex, which people from tier 2, tier 3 cities aspire to be a part of? This is heading in the other direction. How has it worked for him? I'm sure it has its own challenges.
Zoho, being an IT company, they have so many products that they made it easier for the employees and for him to connect well on these apps that they built. It never posed any sort of challenges for them. Yeah, in fact, he told us that currently he's in this village where he's not even facing any connectivity or network issues. So the work is fine and they're not really facing any problems there.
Interesting. And what about talent, Nandika? Given that the whole idea is to not encourage migration to cities where, you know, you spot talent in those local areas and get them to work from there. How has he dealt with that in terms of spotting talent? Has it gotten in the way, or has it actually helped him?
I'd like to bring up this point here. In 2004, Zoho built something called Zoho University, which today is called Zoho Schools of Learning, in which they train the students. And for them, what is more important is not the degree, but the skill sets and abilities of these students. In fact, students don't have to pay fees over here. They are paid a stipend of 10,000 throughout the two-year course. And they started with 6 students back in 2004. And today, they have almost 800 students who have graduated from the school, and most of them are employed with Zoho Corporation. So I think his vision is playing out well here.
Among the leading top 5 IT companies in India, I have a friend whose CV got rejected because he didn't score 50% in his 10th standard. And now he works for a Fortune 500 company in New York. But the fact is that here in Zoho, a couple of examples that he gave is a receptionist turned programmer.
That was a security guard.
Yes, security guard turned programmer. So which only goes to show that it doesn't matter what you scored in your college, but if you have the chops, you'll be trained for it.
And you won't believe, most of the students hail from small towns who only dream to become an engineer. And, Zoho gives them an opportunity to be a part of the school and later their organization.
Right. Some 15 to 20%, you write, in the company do not have an engineering background or a degree rather.
Yes. And they all are trained in the company. The school is built inside the office itself. The employees sit with these students, teach them, and they get to experience real-time office culture. In fact, one very important point that he mentioned was that at the age of 21, these students are employed with a company where other students aged 21 are studying in a college.
It clearly doesn't speak a lot about our primary and secondary education in India. That is one reason why some of these universities do flourish. But the fact is that there are some companies like Zoho. Even HCL had tried it, if I remember correctly, where they train students, and I'm assuming that companies like these will have some sort of an undertaking with the students that, hey, listen, you've got to spend some time with us so that the training doesn't go waste. A model like this has worked, is what inference is then.
Absolutely.
And overall, just take us through his work day, if you had a chance to probe him on that. It must be at odds with what we do in cities.
So he told us that, he wakes up at 4 in the morning and he has some calls to make, in his US office. Mm. And then he does some calls, and after, around 7 or 8, he goes for a long walk. And at times he also goes for swimming in the well. And then he has also set up his agriculture business there, where he grows tomatoes, paddy, brinjal, and so on. And then he comes back to his house. He is living without AC in his house because the village atmosphere is cool. And he mentioned that his energy consumption has dropped dramatically after moving to that village. And after he completes his working hours in the evening, he again goes for a walk. He does not watch TV. He does not like to. He reads some books, listens to some good music. He's very active on Twitter. And then, he just goes to bed early.
He's basically chilling then, from what I understand from you.
Working and chilling together. And that's so cool. And I was like, yeah, I want to do this in future.
I think Tenkasi is calling then, Nandika, for you. You might as well. Yeah, but it might help that he has a significant stake in the company. What lessons does this hold for other companies? Which may have a different shareholding pattern in the first place.
He owns 88% stake in the business. And he has a sister who is a part of the company. His brother-in-law is part of the company. His name is Rajendran Dandapani. He is the president of Zoho Schools of Learning. So majorly he, handles the university bit. Yeah, that's that.
It helps that he calls the shots in terms of setting rules that can be executed quickly.
Since you brought up family here, I'd like to raise this point. Sridhar is one of those entrepreneurs that did not have to go to the market or any venture capital community to raise funds. He practically did it all by himself with a little help from friends and family.
That's an envious position to be in, given that management control rests not with the investors or rather you're not even sharing that with anyone. That helps.
Yes.
In his workday, he spends some amount of time doing code reviews. Now, that is interesting in that for a guy in that position, does like to get hands-on from time to time. Code reviews are actually going into the programming language itself, and reviewing a code is not something that a CEO might want to do in the first place.
Yeah, true that. He takes stock of engineering projects, reviews codes, and takes customer calls.
Taking customer calls and dealing with them and meetings is one thing that's a staple diet of any CEO, but not so code reviews or reviewing code written by programmers.
Absolutely.
So, in terms of getting to where Zoho has got, which is a profitable outfit, this way modus of working where, you know, you mentioned 2004 Zoho University, 2011 building this office in Tenkasi, has it been a slower path to where they have gotten, or is this road that he's taken has actually been a catalyst to get here?
Yeah, I'm sure it was not a very fast one. I think it was a very smart move and intelligent one too. One step at a time, I'd say. They did not rush it, and they were not in a hurry to do something. And in fact, before some years, nobody knew what Zoho is. And I think they built this for themselves and got a name. And I'm sure, yeah, it was not done in any rush or hurry.
Yeah, make haste slowly, as they say.
Exactly.
Thank you, Nandika, for your time on this podcast. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thanks, Abhishek. Bye.
And all your listeners, you can get this podcast on ForbesIndia.com as well as on iTunes. And now you can find us on Spotify and Stitcher as well. To have someone call you for a Forbes India subscription, message Forbes to 51818.